Your brothers and sisters in Christ, have we overtalked the marriage thing in church? I feel like I've had a lot of conversations about marriage lately, and I actually personally feel like I probably haven't talked about it enough from the pulpit, especially when we considered what happened back at the end of July with the Supreme Court's ruling that now same-sex couples can legally be married, and that's kind of the new definition of marriage in our country. But that's not God's definition. And just to be clear, I didn't decide, well, now I want to take my opportunity and preach from the pulpit. I want to turn the pulpit into a political soapbox and tell you what you should do as a citizen of this country and how to vote. No, it just so happens that every single one of our readings today happened to be about family. So my goal is to tell you what God says about marriage and family. When we enter into our gospel reading today, Jesus is inching closer and closer to Jerusalem for the final time. It's all leading up to where he will finally be crucified. And so he's no longer taking any moment of time apart with his disciples, but he is out there in the trenches preaching that word and teaching people so that they can hear more about what he has to say. And so the Pharisees take Jesus up on this opportunity. They come to him, and they ask him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Now the Pharisees and the Jews in general actually had a lot of controversy surrounding that. They knew what the Bible said, but there were different interpretations of it, different ways that their rabbis taught about it. But it's a very telling word. It says they tested Jesus. They weren't actually interested in getting the answer from Jesus to actually know what God says about divorce and marriage and remarriage. Instead, they just simply wanted Jesus to say something that would indict him and that they could have the ruler come down on him and take him out of their lives and stop just throwing a whole wrench into their religious body of believers. See, it was just not that long ago that John the Baptist spoke out about divorce, speaking specifically about the ruler of the day, Herod, and his wife, Herodias. She had gotten divorced just to get married to him. John spoke against it. It cost him his freedom. It cost him his life. So there's probably a little bit of that sitting there for the Pharisees. Like, if Jesus just says something wrong, we can get rid of him. And we don't even have to get our hands dirty. But Jesus responds to their question. What did Moses command you? Now, for those of you who are in the Sunday morning Bible class, guess what? Jesus just pulled a Columbo. He did a Columbo before Columbo even existed. He led with a question. What did Moses command you? Because he wanted to guide this conversation to a very specific point. And so the Pharisees answer him back. They said, Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away. This actually comes from the Old Testament book Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 1. But it was amazing to see the plethora of interpretations around it. Some of us saw that when Moses said you can give a certificate of divorce to your wife and let her walk away, was more about in cases of adultery, in cases of desertion, abuse, things that we would classify as biblical grounds for divorce. But then there were other rabbis who would stand there and say, yeah, if she burnt the dinner tonight, you can just write up that certificate of divorce and send her away and not feel any shame or guilt about it. Many of the Pharisees had in their mind that, well, Moses wrote it, so we can do it whenever we want. We can get divorced whenever we want. God gave us that privilege. He obviously wanted us to get out of our marriages whenever we wanted. But Jesus turns this around and now gives the answer. They've played their hand. They've showed that they just think divorce is okay. Just get divorced whenever you want to. Jesus replied, it was because your hearts were hard that Moses wrote you this law. Jesus was steering that conversation to show them specifically the reason you get divorced is because of your hardness of heart, because of your sin. Because you are a sinner, you willy-nilly just end relationships, end families, this is not the way it was meant to be. Yeah, I did a little bit of research about the leading causes for divorce, and it was very interesting because I read a couple of top 10 lists, I read a couple of actual surveys, national surveys about it, and there are a lot of reasons to get divorced, apparently. Probably the top reasons that I found was lack of communication, lack of trust, finances, whether you have them or you're pursuing them or you don't have them, any one of those could be part of that financial picture of why to get divorced. Disagreements over religion actually was one of the top causes for divorce. And then, of course, there were the other things like adultery, abuse, things that we would say, well, that's okay. We knew that those should be on that list. But then try to find a common thread through all of those things. That's a little bit more difficult. But it truly just goes to what Jesus said. It's because your hearts are hard. It's because you sin, and they sin. Your spouse sins, and you sin against your spouse. Because there are many times when we look at marriage and we think about it more from that aspect of, what is this going to do for me? Instead of thinking about, what is this for the other person? How can I serve them? How can I be the person that God wants me to be in this marriage? Am I going to be centered completely on me and satisfying my desires or looking to them? Because when marriage is all about you, that's when marriage fails. And that's sin, pure and simple. That's self-centeredness. That's narcissism, if you want to use a fancy word. It's serving ourselves instead of the person God has put us in a family with. Sin leads to divorce, and divorce tears apart families. Whether it was for biblical reasons or not, we're not even really going into that. Whether you were divorced for a proper reason or for an improper one, it's still tearing apart families. It takes a husband and wife that are said, as Jesus said, are united together to become one flesh, and pulls them back apart into two. And then when there's kids involved, and the couple gets divorced, then it becomes so much more about, well, who gets the kids when? How long do I get to see them? Whose vacation do I get to go on? Do the kids actually pit the two parents against each other? Divorce breaks families, tears them apart after God created them. But it was not this way from the beginning. That is not the way that God designed it. And that's where Jesus explicitly leads the Pharisees about what God has done. At the beginning of creation, God made the male and female. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they're no longer two, but they are one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. God created family. He created marriage to put a man and a woman together, to have children, to have those wonderful blessings of companionship, of sex, of children. All of that in the confines of marriage and a family. Because it's interesting, when we read from Genesis chapter 2, when you go through that creation count, and each one of the days, you hear Jesus saying at the end, you hear God saying at the end, and it was good. Everything, each time, it was very good. But then we get this little backtrack to Genesis 2. God makes man. He makes Adam. And then in a moment, he says, it is not good for man to be alone. This is not good. So I'll make a helper suitable for him. We know the rest, as it says there, he paraded all the animals in front of Adam. He named them all. He comes to the same conclusion. There's no one else like me on this earth. And then God makes Eve, the first woman. From his own rib, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, she shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. And God put them together in the very first family. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. It's a wonderful thing that God created. Family, marriage, children, And the blessings even go beyond that companionship aspect, beyond the loneliness part. Even what Jesus says in that part that's connected with it, which seems a little almost disjointed, but when the little children are coming to Jesus, we're reminded what children can do for us. That even in our marriage, that as we're trying to raise them up in the way of the Lord and train them in how they should go, children make us reflect for a moment and remember what faith is all about. That it's just so simple. It's so humble. To believe as just a child believes. To believe as just a child just accepts it, that there is a God. He loves me. He died for me. And he's going to take me to heaven. That's why Jesus said about these children, and why he made sure, don't hinder them. Because he says, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter. But still, even being free from sin, we find that there are many things that we do to destroy families. That doesn't matter. You may be married, you might be not. When we go into a relationship and we treat it about what we get out of it, when we treat it as, this is for me, and I might occasionally serve you, it has the complete wrong focus to it. When we pull other people away from their families just to serve our own desires and our own needs, thinking nothing of their family, we work to distance them. When we look down upon children, when we think, you know, this really isn't for them. Or if there's other moments where we actually push them away, we don't give them our time and our attention. We go to move our family apart instead of bringing them together. We do things to separate this family instead of unifying it. We're all guilty of it. Whether we're married or not, with all our interactions with family, it's because we have sin. We have hearts that are sinful. But that's why Jesus came. That's why he comes along, and just as we're told in the second reading from Hebrews chapter 2, that he suffered death. He tasted death for everyone. He did this to make us holy, to bring us, really, as a part of his own family. That's why it says that both the one who makes people holy and those who are made holy are of the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them, to call us, brothers and sisters. Jesus has suffered for our sins. He did this specifically to make that creation expand even further than that immediate biological sense of family. He made it to extend that all people who would believe in him would be part of his family, that they would be on that equal footing, that you would be called brother or sister by our Lord and Savior, by our God. He made us family to him. He did it when he brought us into his family through the holy waters of baptism. He did it washing us clean, making us right with him. You are a part of God's family as well as your family. So what do we do from here? God does have things to say for husbands and wives, for children. He tells us in Ephesians 5, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. That's your paradigm. That's your example. To treat them how Christ treated you. To put you first. To live according to God's law. To serve this person out of love. Wives, submit to your husbands as the church submits to Christ. To follow the person that God has brought into a family with you. To follow their lead. To do all that you can to make this Christian, to make your husband a good, God-pleasing Christian man. Children, obey your parents. Honor your father and mother, as the Lord says. And even in Ephesians 6, it says, fathers, don't exasperate your children, but train them in the instruction of our Lord. train them in the way they should go. When we seek to serve our families, then we seek to fulfill the Lord's purpose in those families. When we do that, we work towards what Jesus said as he answered that question about divorce. It's not about how can I get out of this, or about what I can get out of it, but how can I serve the family that God has created for me? How can I help that phrase that Jesus said, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Seek to serve and love your family today and always, knowing that Christ has brought you into his family.